compensated for those licenses that are sort of not eligible, doesn't qualify as charity. I'd also note that, you know, on the teaching side, some things just don't make a lot of sense. It doesn't make a lot of sense to me to say that, fine, as a prof, I can bring a photocopy machine to the front of the classroom and invite my students up, line up to make a photocopy of a three-page article, and that's permitted, but I can't make can't photocopy that on behalf of the students myself. I just don't understand. It just doesn't strike me as logical. In terms of that decision, that too is under appeal. It's a decision that dramatically increased the prices of the secondary schools, K-12 schools pay as part of copy. And listen, it involved a large amount of study and a lot of debate. We'll see what the federal court says. So it's tough to render a full opinion, sort of a full opinion of where it ends up, because I don't think we know yet, other than it's clearly going to increase the cost of education in the near term and potentially in the long term. There is certainly an impact, though, I think, on what takes place at the university level, post-secondary level, where we've seen universities typically pretty conservative in terms of their willingness to push the boundaries a little bit. It's a decision that I think will make it more likely that they'll be willing to settle and try to reach an agreement, even if it means paying for some things that long as they don't necessarily have to.
A lot of innovation, be it industrial innovation or in the digital environment, depends on access to a wealth of knowledge that came before. So do you think that there is a link between innovation, creativity, and copyright? And if so, what would an overly restrictive copyright law, what would its effect?
Thousands of innovations around 2000, I mean, yes, you're all getting little bits of effort. And my response at that meeting in terms of the link was, of course, there are certainly some people who create specifically because of the work of compensation, and they rely on intellectual property too. Now, I think they can do that, frankly, under the current law, and I don't think the kinds of changes that we saw in C61 really change that calculus very much at all. So yes, there is a link. At the same time, I would argue that link is grossly exaggerated in many instances, both for the reasons that you might see from Banker and others, but we see all kinds of creativity and innovation taking place outside the norm of saying it's specifically because I have a copyright or I have a patent that I create. People create and do things for all kinds of different reasons, some of which are commercial, some of which are non-commercial, for which the IP laws don't apply. But even more, if you take a look at what goes into innovation and how a country becomes innovative, yes, IP laws matter, but so does education, so does functioning market system, so does solid government. I mean, there's lots of different things, and that's just in developed countries or the developing world. Electricity, running water seems to me to be a bit more important than copyright laws. And the way that I put it to the person who was asking was, Morocco has one of the toughest copyright laws in the world. They signed a free trade agreement with the United States. The U.S. now says if you want to sign a free trade deal with them, you've got to adopt U.S. laws in order to do it. So there is literally not only are there tons of provisions on intellectual property, there's a whole 40-page side letter that goes to the level of detail that says what an ISP in Marrakesh has to do if somebody claims that it's hosting an infringing fine. I mean, it's to that level of specificity. And I don't know anybody that would argue that Morocco is more innovative than Canada right now, or a better place for innovation in Canada right now, just because it's got a better copyright. So many other factors. And so yes, IP is linked with innovation. But if our only focus on trying to create an innovative country, because I most agree that there's benefits to that, is to say that we've got to get our intellectual property laws right, and we neglect education, and we neglect so many of the other factors that come into this, a tax system that entices people to invest in, a country that has a good enough quality of life that people stay here rather than going elsewhere. And there's so many different factors that come into play. And part of the unfortunate part, I think, of the discussion has been there are those who boil innovation down so that they think that innovation is directly linked to IP and only IP. And I think it's just that simply wrong. Let's see, one more.
If IP laws were passed, how would they enforce these laws?
Okay, that was probably the most popular question I got after 61. probably not going to be able to enforce against that at all. So you can lock down the GDD, so that might be good news for you can lock down the DVD, and you can say it's an infringing act to unlock the DVD. I don't think tamper is going to disappear just because we passed the C61, but people are going to know about it. But where the law can be enforced and would be enforced is against the so-called good guys. It's against educators, as an example, right? Where I see the guidelines that come up at my university, and I imagine we get there are similar kinds of copyright guidelines that come up in almost every education institution. And so if we're told as educators that we can't show that excerpt from a DVD, let's say it's a media criticism course, you can't show that excerpt because you can't get that digital law, they're not going to do it. I mean, frankly, educators are afraid to begin with that they might be infringing copyright. And so that notion that there are now these new rules, they will follow those rules. So it'll affect educators. It affects similarly researchers in many of the same institutions. I had someone come into my office after C61 was introduced, who's engaged in biblical studies research. And she takes a look at how modern media examines displays stories from the Bible. And so she had a grant proposal out to one of the major granting agencies. The idea was to take several different movies and put them on a hard drive and take various scenes and engage in the research. Well, would I be able to do that if C61 is passed? And the answer was, well, no. Because there was no obvious succession that would allow you to do that. And her response was, well, then I can't apply for the grant because I signed an ethics document through the ethics office and I applied for the grant, which says that I'm compliant with the law. If I'm not compliant with the law, I can't apply for the grant, I can't do the research. So would this kind of legislation affect the people who may be engaging in file sharing or other sorts of activity where it infringes? It's very, very difficult to enforce. Frankly, it's unlikely that you'd see enforcement but for the kind of network-based enforcement that we see, for example, in the Kindle example. Where it does affect us are those that are actually trying to follow the rules, those that actually do go ahead and make the purchases and try to evolve their education. Those are the ones who become most eager to do that.
Thank you very much, sir.